Nia Dohote. How's everybody today? Today I have a special mission. And my mission today is to help everybody understand how important it is to tell stories to children. This is my mission. I was raised by my grandmother, so I was always encircled by wonderful grandmas, her friends, and they told stories in many languages. And my grandmother understood probably two or three different indigenous languages, and she also understood a bit of French. She tried to speak French, and I always got a kick out of that. So I was very fortunate, and I had a lot of aunties. I'm from way up north. I'm from the Yukon Territory, and I'm from the Nacho Nayak Dan First Nation. Nacho, for all of you, means big river. And it is a big river, the river that my ancestors came from. Now, what you should know about the stories that I'm going to tell you is that some of them are thousands of years old. Some of them are happening as I speak. Some of them happened during my grandmother's lifetime. Some of them during my mother's time. Some of them during my time, when I was a child, when I was a young woman, when I was a young mother. Now, the thing that you should also know about the Nacho Nayak Dan people is that listening is a skill. And it is a skill that was taught by listening to stories, listening to your environment, listening to everything that's going on around you. Why? Well, my ancestry, my great-great-great-great-great-grandparents were hunters. They were gatherers. They were fishermen. They were trappers. They built their own houses. They fed their family the food that they harvested, the animals that they were able to take down. Well, put yourself into the place of a hunter. I'll tell you a little story to demonstrate this. In the fall, when the grouse were nice and fat, these are little birds that my grandmother would hunt. She would take her little .22, and little backpack, and I would take my little backpack, and she'd say, "We're going to get some grouse. They're waiting for us." And we would head down the road. Her with her little .22. She had a little knife on the side of her little belt that she had around her waist. As soon as we reached the end of this little bush road and we're beginning to walk into the woods, into the bush, I had to be silent. She had trained me to be this way. She said, "You are entering somebody else's home. You are entering a place where they have very good ears. You see the rabbit? His ears go this way and that way so that he's not in danger. You see the moose? He's standing there. His ears are also moving around. He's practicing his hearing so that he is warned of danger." So when you enter, you must be very quiet. This is to honor them. Those creatures that are going to feed us, we have to be quiet. So when I was in the woods with my grandmother, I tried very hard not to make noise. Now, I don't know how many of you go fishing, but that's fun. And if you were at the side of a little creek and you throw your hook in and you're making all kinds of noise, well, of course, the fish will hear you and they will go away. So listening is important to your survival. So with that, I'll tell you a little story about my grandmother when she was a child. When she was a child, there was very few newcomers in the Yukon. And on the Nacho, which is in English called the Stewart River, many people came in there. They were looking for precious metal, like silver, like gold, maybe copper. But in those days, my people, the precious metals were copper, if they could find it, but obsidian. Obsidian is a type of metal that is very black, and it's like glass. And the people used to have these placed onto a willow, and they'd use that as a knife, very sharp. In fact, they say that the early surgeons used to use this obsidian stone to do surgery. It has such a fine edge and never loses its edge. If you're lucky and you're looking around in the bush in the Yukon, you might find one of these that somebody has lost or dropped, or maybe when they were making it, it was just garbage to them. Garbage that goes back to the earth. So my great-grandparents were camped along the edge of this beautiful river called the Nacho. And my grandfather, great-grandfather, had made friends with a Frenchman. And when Grandma told me this story, she said, "I never did know his name. We just called him Frenchie, because he's from France." And my father, she said, she really enjoyed his company, because he too, he smoked pipe. So my dad and him used to smoke pipe together. Grandma was telling this story to me and my cousin as we were out there helping her in her little smoke shed. She was cutting meat and smoking meat when we shared the story. So she said, "You know, one day Frenchie came from up the river. He was looking for silver." She said, "I don't know why he's so hungry for silver, but he looked for little shiny rocks. And one time he told my dad," because my dad was curious, she said, "Frenchie," he said, "what do you always look around for?" He said, "I'm looking for a shiny rock." He said, "I know where there's some." And my dad took him right there. Oh boy, Frenchie's sure happy. My dad don't know why he's so crazy for shiny rocks. We don't know. So Frenchie came this one time to visit, and he was talking with my dad. He knew how to speak some of our language too, this Frenchie. How he learned it? From us, I guess. He said to my dad, that's what my grandma said, told my dad, "You know, my mom is getting really old, and she's in France. I gotta go back," he said. "I gotta go back and see her before she pass away." Oh, my dad, she said, he look at him. He know he just got small boat, canoe. How he gonna make it across big water? I don't know. He worry for him. He told my mom, she said, "I don't think you're gonna make it with that little boat." What my great-grandpa didn't know is that he's going to go up to around White Horse, and then he goes across, and then he's going to take a boat. But my grandma didn't know that. "Yeah," he said, "I'm going to go there." He said, "Next spring, you watch for me." He said, "When the ice breaks up, that's about the time I'm going to come back. You watch for me." So my great-grandma, my great-grandpa, they went down, they say goodbye to him, they give him something to eat, they wrap up something and give it to him. Wave to him in the river. So grandma said, "So, my dad, he got a heavy heart," she said, because she think to himself, "Maybe I'm never going to see him again. Here, next spring, all the ice just exploding in the river, big chunks of ice breaking up, clearing out in the spring. After all the ice go, a little bit on the edge, here my great-grandma, she's down getting some water. Hey, she hollered to us, somebody coming. We all rushed down there. Here's the Frenchie paddling his boat. Big smile, he's coming. He got big whisker too. Come. Oh boy, when he pulled his boat up there, my dad just hugged him. Good to see you, so son, he said. Happy to see his friend. My dad brought his big pack up for him. My grandma started cooking for him too, feed him. After supper, my dad and him, they load up their pipe. They go smoke pipe together. Oh boy. They smoke that pipe and they drink their tea in joy. Here his big pack was there. He told my dad, I brought something for you, he said, from France. And he reached in there, he pulled it out. It's wrapped up in paper. That's the first time I saw paper. I don't know what it is. I think to myself, must be some kind of skin from animal in France. Nice smooth one. He got a little string around it too. He give it to my dad. Here it's knife. Real steel knife. My dad never had that kind. My dad had copper knife. He got bone knife, stone knife. This a real knife, he can't believe it. He even got a little whetstone too for him to sharpen. Hey, Mossy, he's so happy to get it. Then he dig out something else. He pull it out for my mom. Copper kettle. She never boiled soup before in copper kettle. She wished for it because she see other people got pot, copper or metal pot. She don't have it. If she wants to make soup, she takes the stomach of that animal. She cuts the meat up, put it inside that stomach, put water inside. She let the fire burn down. And when it's just the right temperature, she puts that stomach up in a hook over that little fire. And the way the stomach is, it twists around, then it twists around this way. Pretty soon that soup, that water start to boil. Oh boy, she cook it nice. You can't let fire catch on because it's gonna ruin your pot. So after it's all cooked, pour it into a little birch bark bowl, eat that soup, eat the meat, eat the pot. You can only use it one time. So here she got that beautiful pot. Hey, she's so grateful. Masi cho, she told the Frenchie. Then Frenchie dig around in there some more. He bring something. He tried to give it to me. Oh, I jumped back behind my grandma. In our way, we have to show great respect to older people, especially men. If you're a girl, not supposed to talk to man. It's not our way. And I don't want to take it. But my grandma, she said, it's okay. Frenchie, he don't know our way, and he likes our family. He's good to us. So I took what he give me. It's wrapped up too in that little paper. I don't know what it is. Brown paper. I open it. Blue shoes. Blue leather. I never see that before. It got little buttons down the side too, like little boots. How do you know my size? I put it on. Oh boy, I can't believe it. I just wear moccasin all the time. Boy, I'm so happy. Right next to our tent, we live in tent that time made out of caribou skin. My cousin right next door to us, my auntie, my uncle, and my cousin, I can't wait to show her what I got. My cousin, her name Natua. Natua means water on the face. Why? Because she's crybaby. She cry all the time for things. So I went out of our tent. I went to her. I said, Natua, look what I got. What? Look, I got shoe from Frenchie. Oh, how come you don't bring me any? She started to cry. Well, in our way to, you know, if you have something is precious to you, if your friend needs it or wants it, you have to give it to them. So I don't know what to do. I ran back, I talked to my grandma. I said, Natua wants my shoes. And my grandma said, I don't think that's a good idea. You know, Frenchie, he don't understand when we get something, we should give it away. So I keep them shoes. Oh boy, that night I went to sleep. Springtime, you know, I like to sleep close to the door. Nice fresh air come in, even though we got a little stove in there. And when I take off my shoes, she said, I clean a little dust off with my spit. I put it there, just in the right place, just to jump in the morning. I went to sleep. Maybe I even dream about those shoes, I don't know. In the morning, I'm gonna jump right into them. I woke up, all cut up. Them boots are all cut. I know who did that. I went to my grandma. I cry. She comforted me. It's okay, she said. She took them little boots. She took that same little paper there. She tied it up. You go give it to her now, she said. So I went out of the tent next door. I said, Natua, Natua, I got something for you. She don't answer. Natua, huh? Come out, I got something nice for you. Finally, she came out. I had them little shoes behind me. She walked close to me, I walked to her. Natua, I said, you know, yesterday, I don't want to give you them boots, those shoes, but today, you could have it. You know, all my life, my best friend is Natua. That's the story. So what did you hear in this story? What did you listen to? Did you hear the sound of the ice breaking on the river? Did you hear the sorrow of the little girl whose little boots were cut up? Did you hear the happiness of my great-grandfather when his friend came back? Many things you heard in that story, not just the story. You heard many emotions, things going on in your heart. You know, the fear that his friend would not come back, the love shown between the grandmother, my grandmother, her husband, these are my great-grandparents, how they respected everybody around them, no matter where they came from. There's a lot of things in these stories. So this is what I am trying to share. It's a sharing of different ways of learning. Did you know that you can make more dried meat from a caribou than from a whole moose? Did you know that? It's because the caribou is lean and mean. And he has much more tender meat. So I think this next story, probably because I'm hungry for caribou meat at this time of the year. The caribou, they like to winter in winter and summer in summer. So they have a migration. They migrate from the Yukon to Alaska and then they return. So I'll tell you that story. This story is from my dear auntie, Mary Vitrakoa. We were there as an archaeology team, and this was up the Black Stone. It's a very beautiful river basin. And this used to be the campsite of the Vantat, Dago, and the Vitlit, caribou hunters of that area. And this is where the caribou would be migrating. They would come back into the Yukon. And as my old grandpa used to say, that's our grocery store. We just wait for our grocery store to come. And flying over that region with a chopper, which we did, you can see the remnants, the remains of caribou corrals, which they would take 2 or 3 years to make because they had to go quite a ways for spruce trees, haul them on sleds, on toboggans with a dog team, and they made a huge corral and a chute that went into this corral. So the hill would come up over this way, the caribou would be coming in here, all the women and children would steer the caribou into this chute. And around that corral would be these men. So I'll tell you that story. That was the grocery store. To Auntie Mary, for Auntie Mary, most loving woman that I ever met. You know, years ago, she said, there was one couple. They live a little bit out of the village where all the people were camped. They live a little bit outside of the camp. I don't know. I guess they're kind of protecting themselves or something. I don't know why, but she said they lived outside of the camp encampment where they were hunting, waiting for caribou. She said, you know, she can't have children. Maybe that's why she don't want to be in the village. Maybe she feel more sad when she sees a children running around. I don't know. Anyways, this couple live up there, old man, old woman. Not that old, but too old to have children. No matter what they did, they see medicine man try to find a way to get pregnant, it can't work. And this one day that woman was out on the land, she was snaring ptarmigan. You know you could make 2 snares out of 1 eagle feather. You take the outside of the feather off, you just take the middle part there, the quill, just slice it down the middle, so you got 2. This is just turned into like a little wire, and you can make 2 snares out of 1 eagle feather. You make little toggles, tie a little moose skin on it, and you put it on a little willows. And you see them ptarmigan, and you rush them, and they're gonna run into the snare. You're gonna catch it. So this woman, she set lots of snares. You don't have to just stay around and catch them. You can catch them and go pick up your snares the next day. And this is what she did. And when she was walking towards where she had set her snares, she thought she heard a baby crying. What? Must be the wind. She listened again. Sure enough, it was a baby crying. So she went quickly towards that sound, towards the sound of the baby crying. She walked very quickly. Here's a baby laying on the ground. Its umbilical cord is tied on, is connected to that little tiny spruce tree. You know, in the Yukon, it's such a slow growing season. Maybe that little spruce tree is 50 years old, but it's very skinny. That little baby was tied, connected to the spruce. She can't believe it, it's a little boy baby. Ah! She took her little knife off of her little belt there. She cut the cord. She put that baby under her perk. She can't believe it. All those prayers, all that wishful thinking, hoping, had now been satisfied. She got a baby. So she took that baby home. Her husband came home. Look, she said. He gave us baby. Well, it didn't take long, you know. They figured out how to feed that baby. They gave that baby little caribou soup. They used little caribou skin, feed him. And they say that, you know, even though you haven't had a child, if you put that baby to your breast, a woman can make milk. She did that. Pretty soon that baby got healthy. Start to grow. They're so happy. But the first few months they had him, oh, he cried so hard. They thought maybe it was because he was hungry. But the mother discovered something. When he started to cry, she'd wrap him up. She would go out of their little caribou skin tent. She showed him the moon. And a vitlit, she said. Moon. He stopped crying. A couple of nights later, he started crying again. She showed him the moon again. Oh, she told her husband, I think we got moon baby. I think he's from moon people. We got to just keep good care of him. Yes, he said. I believe you're right. Well, this little boy, he didn't grow like a regular child. He just stayed short, very short. And his mother made him little marten skin pants. Little fur pants out of marten. They call him thuktul. I mean marten skin pants. And when she's walking across the land on the tundra, you know, because he's so short, he can't navigate good. So even though he's 10 years old, she packed him. She packed a little moon boy when they're out on the land. Now, one of the things, you know, that lots of people, they don't realize, and some people have this misunderstanding that Indigenous people lived very comfortably all the time. That's not true. Many years they starved. Many years maybe winter come too fast. Maybe got a poor fish run. You don't know. And so that story is like this too. This one year, they're waiting for their grocery store to come, you know, the caribou's gonna come back. They're gonna get lots of caribou. This year, caribou took a different trail. They changed their migration path on occasion, so changed their trail. Oh boy, people starving. baby crying. Some people even die from starvation. Bad situation. Now that little boy, he went to his mother when he realized what's going on in the little encampment. "Ma," he said, "I can bring caribou back." "What?" "I'm gonna try," he said. "I'm gonna make song for caribou, bring him back." Auntie Mary told me, "Sitchi," I mean granddaughter, "Sitchi, I'm so sorry. I don't know the song. It's so old story. I can't remember the song." She said that little guy, he went outside of their tent. They got little dome-shaped tent. He went out. He got two sticks. He broke off some willows. He went out and he hit these sticks together. And he sang his heart out. He sang really loud, she said, and hit them sticks. You see, when the caribou move across the land, their horns, they click each other. You hear them when they're migrating. They grunt, they fart, their antlers come together. Moving. He made some of those sounds. And he sang this song to them, caribou song. Auntie Mary said, "I think he begged them to come." Pretty soon, she said, over on the rise, bull caribou, he's chief. All his people come behind him. He always come ahead, check it out. See if things are okay to go. Now, before he sang that song, he told his mother, "I'm gonna make this song for the people so they don't starve. The only thing I want for my work," he said, "I want the stomach fat from caribou. It's the fat that goes around the outside of the stomach. In English, we call this lace fat from the caribou. It's a delicacy. You smoke it in the cache, you smoke it, and you can just break it off. It's energy food. We eat that with the dried meat. It's very precious." "That's all I want," he said. "Okay." He said, "Go tell the people that's what I want for my pay." Okay, so she went and she told the people, "My son, he's going to make medicine. He's going to make a song, bring caribou." "Ah," they said, "all he wants, he just wants the lace fat." "Okay." So she went back to her tent. When after he sang that song, him and his mother sat in their tent. And the father went out to the village, to the little encampment, to wait with the hunters. Sure enough, that big bull come, and all the caribou came behind. And people that had enough energy, the women, they steered the caribou into the big corral. There was a huge slaughter there. They killed them with arrow and clubs and spear. Meanwhile, that mother and her little boy is waiting. "What kind of people I live with," he said. "And Davidly, I want to go back to the moon." "Son," she said, "what's the matter?" He said, "All this time, I thought I'd live amongst trustworthy people. Now nobody bring me fat." "Oh, son," she said, "be patient. They're working with meat. They're going to bring it." So he waited patiently. Nobody brought anything. He felt bad. His mother felt bad. Pretty soon his father came home, and the evening after cutting meat and everything, "Hey son, people brought you fat?" "No. And the vitlik. I want to go back to my people. I want to go back to them." "Oh son, don't think that way." They tried their best. They even put him in bed between them that night. But despite their efforts, in the morning when they woke up, they saw in the little smoke hole those little fur pants was hanging there. He had gone home. And now you look at the full moon there, when there's a big full moon in the fall and the caribou start moving back to winter in the Yukon. You look on there, you're going to see that little guy there, Suksul. He's standing like this, and he's got some caribou stomach fat. And that's the story. So whenever you have an opportunity for somebody to hear somebody tell a story, you should stop. You should listen. Listen with the understanding that perhaps there's something in there that will be for you. When you get older, you'll be able to take that little teaching, that little lesson that you learned in that story, and be a better person for it.